Hello and good evening. My name is Richard Miller, and welcome to Never Not Here. And nowadays I'm realizing if I'm saying good morning or good evening somewhere out there, it's a different time. And that's so good morning too. And sometimes I like to say a few things, but whether they're really insightful or meaningful, I mean, in a way, the world is worried and something's not right. You know, it seems like something's missing. And it appears that that gives us a lot of motivation. And we're moving. And some of us even say, or some of us even think, that without something be missing, we'd lack so much progress, whatever the heck progress is. And there's a frustration about, you know, what is progress, and what have we been doing for the years we've been chasing our missing items, our checklist of missing things. And so then I guess at one point or another we seek advice and we say, well, how come even when I get things, something's still missing? And is that all I get out of life, a lack, or can I really ever get fulfilled or a fullness? And sure, we have some minutes when, moments, and even more than moments, when we feel fulfilled, when we have a child, when the child grows up, when a lot of times it's just by benchmarks, because we're only looking when the child graduates, or, you know, when we get a promotion, or the benchmarks are the ones we celebrate, and the moment by moment, it seems like we're struggling through them, or just saying, don't bother me, I'm busy. And so then here we are again. We're just saying, well, what is it we're doing, and what brings us here anyhow, and what can we learn when we come together? And whether it's a learning, or whether it's a feeling, or whether it's a transformation, you can call it what you like. And you might know that I'm sometimes nomadic, and I'm telling people, and you, I'm telling that I'm going to Australia. So in one way, I'm already there, because my energy is just there, and I feel it. And the level of my energy is totally up for an adventure. And so I'm in Australia again tonight, and please help me welcome Isaira. So nice to be with you.
Thank you, Richard, and it's wonderful to be with you. Thank you for having me in this space of sharing.
The world is so small, and this space of sharing is so potent these days, because we can, you know, maybe that's our last chance as humanity, is the internet, if they ever snatch that away from us. I don't know what we're going to be left with.
Well, I guess, you know, in a way, it's quite fascinating that we're seeing a physical object can give us the recognition of closeness. And your comment, it's such a small world, I feel, is reflected in this deeper quest for truth, that even though we can be on the other side of the world, if we're present in consciousness, we are in the same room. Consciousness is the space in which we are always connected. We are always close. There's no distance, because we realize we are the one same being.
So even days don't matter. You're on one day, I'm on another day, and that's all artificial, really.
Right. Well, what is that? Here we are in the same now, isn't it?
You know, I don't know where I applied it. Several times I applied it, but I just had this thought once that if I was in a spaceship, kind of in intergalactic space, but not in the solar system, and I looked out the window, what would I see? Dots, right? And then 5 minutes later, I'd look out, I'd see dots, right? I'd have windows all around. And everywhere I looked, I would just see the lights of stars, right, and galaxies, but I wouldn't know the difference. I wouldn't see any planets or any kind of light or sharp light, like because I wasn't close to a star. I'm just way in intergalactic space. So then no matter where I look or what I do, I see the same thing. And in a way, that's like eternity, because you can realize that time, day and night, seasons, hours and seconds all have to do with the planet Earth. And somehow the universe doesn't really have any of that time. Just
It has to do with a reference point, really. It depends on our perspective, where we place our perspective. That reference point gives us distinction or differentiation. Without a referencing point, there is no differentiation, there is no distinction. So planet Earth is about that experience. And we were talking the other day about contrasts, that because of the contrast, we come to discover what union actually is, ironically.
In a way, it's like the reference point. Without a reference point, can we be humanity? Would a human be able to exist without a reference point?
Absolutely not. Can the experience exist without a reference point? Can any experience be had without a reference point? Not.
That's a very deep question, you know. It's a very deep question that we could contemplate. In other words, like all the things we complain about and duality and the good part and the bad part. I mean, without that, without all those references, what? It's just space,
exactly.
Right? It's just space. It's not our experience. There's no growth possible, or there's no recognition or registration. There's we were not really registering. You know, even an activity or an event is kind of like a made-up thing that's built on reference points.
Exactly. And it's about the encounter. And this is one of the things I feel is deeply misunderstood in terms of the spiritual quest, that oftentimes it's considered that the experience of duality, perceived duality, okay, because it is only a perception-based experience. In ultimate terms, duality doesn't exist. And within the essence of the universe is this play, this dynamic of consciousness, that we are having this encounter through a reference point. So as I was saying, I feel it's a greatly misunderstood aspect of creation in spiritual terms. The thought that we're somehow supposed to overcome this dualistic perspective, we're supposed to renounce it or leave it or transcend it. Can we leave it when it is an aspect of the all? Can we depart from that? Or is it that we are to embrace it and allow it to be an aspect of consciousness, an aspect of the universe? And as we were saying, without that, without the reference point, there is no encounter. If there is no encounter, can there be any being? If there is no being, is there existence? Is there creation?
The last person I was talking to, we were talking about the vastness, and that the vastness has no preferences. And I thought, in a way, that was somewhat dangerous, because to say that or believe that, or, you know, perhaps the vastness has no preferences, but the things that appear in the vastness do. Like we were talking about the instinct for survival and the instinct for motherhood and I said, why is the experience of vastness, how do you know that supersedes the instinct for survival? And can you really say that, you know, there are no preferences? And like, I don't know, I guess no preferences doesn't really mean I don't care. It means something else.
I feel it's about a distinction between prejudice rather than preferences, like the prejudice mind that cannot accept all aspects of existence, creation and destruction, being born and dying, even though, of course, we know ultimately there's no death, it's just constant transformation. But this point about preferences and distinctions, it does give us the journey of life. It's like the rhythm, the beat within eternity. If there is no beat within eternity, can there be eternity? If there is no punctuation, can there be an everlasting journey? So I see that what we call our preferences, our experience in this human realm, where we do have choices and we distinguish between this and that, what we like, what we don't like. Really, this is that dance, that rhythm of the universe. It is the punctuation of existence, just repeating itself over and over and over. And as you were saying, really, can we be existence without that? Is it for us to actually say, no, that is wrong, we should overcome that, and this non-differentiated self that is consciousness supersedes all? Or is it that really these are the two faces of the one same being, that simultaneously existence is multiplicity, in which preferences and distinctions do exist, and absolute being beyond distinction, the all one? Eka na eka, one not one. Isn't it that existence is this, right here, right now, simultaneously, boundless, formless, beyond distinction, and yet that which gives birth to and contains infinite expressions? Isn't this to be celebrated?
I think my whole purpose of being involved here is really to clear up some misunderstandings, you know, because I'm not going to be able to create it, what's true, or I'm not going to really probably be able to embody what's true. But I can maybe point to what misunderstandings occur, and everybody that can notice that might say, you know, they're on their own for what their experience is. I have nothing to tell, or the people that come on this space really have nothing to tell how your experience should be or how your life should unfold. But that's probably the only thing I really want to do is talk about the misunderstandings.
Sure. And that's part of the journey of expanding our consciousness, moving from limited perceptions or conditioned beliefs and ideas, that we're all part of that collectively. We're all in this human journey where we've taken on so many confined ideas and we've conformed to so many different beliefs, belief systems, that we lose touch with the essence which is so free to encounter and experience truth in everything, in every moment, in every degree, in every corner of the universe. And the more we surrender and open to this, the more those misconceptions drop away naturally, just by being present, by surrendering and opening ourselves, opening in awareness and sharing in awareness together. We bring greater consciousness to our experience. And it's consciousness that sees what is, just sees. It doesn't have to explain. It can't even be defined. It can't be encapsulated in a single moment, a single definition. It can only be experienced. Which brings us back to the point we were sharing about earlier, which is, without this apparent distinction, this reference point, is there any encounter? So how can it possibly be wrong that we are having this experience of being this apparent individual? How can that be wrong? Perhaps it's that we've misplaced our identity with it. We've become caught in the notion that this appearing individuality, this is a singular identity, and that somehow we are this singular identity, rather than that actually we're this infinite, all-present consciousness with a body, with singularity. And that reference point gives us the capacity to meet the all, to gaze into the face of every other part of myself, to see the infinite expressions, moment to moment, unfolding always in the moment, always here and everywhere. This is the beauty that's being shared here.
I think what we're saying is that this individual, and we're saying it takes the encounters with this individual really to have experience, but this individual is a construct.
Right.
And so that construct, maybe it's not all as flexible as it could be, because it's totally flexible. It's a construct. But if we get to believe in it that it's not flexible, it's stuck, actually, and it's stuck in a place where a lot of stuff is missing, then we want to talk about the vastness and say that, look, you are actually the vastness, and this is a construct, you know. And then I think we're given a misleading idea that says you are the vastness, so that's what you should be. You should be the vastness even now and all and forever, you know. And when you're the vastness, when you somehow admit that you're or seem to have the evidence that you're the vastness day in and day out, then there's some arrival point there. And we're saying that's, now we're kind of saying, well, that's not really an arrival point. That's kind of just like a parking garage where, you know, like where you disengage, where you disengage the machine of my construct and somehow, I don't know whether it's enjoyable or not there, you know. I think people enjoy it because it's free and light and peaceful, and they don't enjoy it because it's cold and sterile and maybe even as far as uncaring.
Right, and I feel also because of the misconceptions about our relating with that aspect of ourself, there is a disengaging. There is the inclination to want to become transcendent and leave behind this construct, as you put it. And I feel in another way it's actually an instrument. It's a conduit through which we encounter existence. And
well, could we say there's a construct, there's an instrument that allows us to build a construct?
Right. Or our misidentification with the instrument is what generates our construct or our perceived construct of this identity, how we identify with life. Because of the nature of the instrument being an individualized aspect, it seems as if we are separate from each other. It seems as if we're separate from existence. And it has to go through that experience in order to be a reference point. It must become its own identity, in a sense, in some degree. And it's because of that that consciousness is misplaced with that. We become falsely identified with this instrument. That's when the construct is built. That's where the construct emerges from, that misidentification. So when we re-engage with consciousness, it's not about us transcending, it's about us witnessing once again the true nature of this instrument, that it is not a construct. There is no construct, because the true nature of this instrument is fluid, is all connected, is all open. Even if we deconstruct this so-called instrument or construct, what do we discover? Even at a material level, what do we discover? 99.84378% space. Not even 0.1% of this so-called construct is physical or matter. So when we come back to the essence of consciousness, you know, people's quest for this vastness, this spaciousness, is not to get away from what we are, it is to reawaken to what we are, to see again the true nature of ourself, this which is simultaneously all open and flowing. It is never fixed, it is never contained, it can never be defined. It is ever present, it is simultaneously form and the formless. We are the individuation within the one undefined being, and this individuation is the gift, the instrument through which we encounter this vastness of creation, this eternal presence of life. So it's imminent consciousness, the vastness, is immanent, not transcendent. That is a misconception. And most spiritual seekers are on the lookout for the transcendent. They're hoping that somehow they can find that peace, which is away from how they've identified with this construct. And of course, it is essential we reconnect with that vastness, that consciousness, to disengage from our false perceptions. Yes, that's essential, but that's not the home. That's not the place we're meant to try and fling ourselves to, project ourselves away from this. The journey isn't about transcending this. It's about realizing our transcendent self is imminently here, always, forever present, forever free, forever whole, one vast, boundless being in and through this instrument of life.
I think we're saying some very important things, and I want to kind of stay with them for a while and maybe even be a little repetitive, but maybe from some different angles. But I can understand the vastness, and then I understand this instrument, which is the individuation. And then mm-hmm. I can understand the construct, which is just some ideas and agreements, and mm-hmm. see and kind of like memory pictures of how we've related with certain entities or with other beings. And so then that the construct part is the part that can change. And I don't know, is it the thinner the construct becomes, the better dancers we are in this life? Or, I mean, I know when you're talking about the individuation or the instrument as apart from the construct, and some people think there should be no construct, but I'm not so sure that ever can happen.
Well, I see that the more fluid we become, the more centered we become, and the more attuned we are from consciousness rather than from our mind, yes, the more we dance, the more we're open, the more we're present in the now. We know and see the true nature of ourself and all of life, which is that which is forever changing, that which is forever all connected with all. And the aspect of our makeup, our human makeup, that is by nature construct, if we think about it, is the mind. It is the mind that operates in dualistic measures. It is the mind that operates with a collection of images and interpretations. And that construct actually has a functioning purpose. It's not that we are meant to discard entirely that function. That function serves us very well as this manifest level of experience. For example, because of that construct and its functioning, I can go to a door anytime repeatedly and my hand reaches out and I open the door without having to work out how to open the door. If I did not have this construct and the function of the mind, every time I went to a door, I would have to work out how to open it all over again. What a waste of energy in this experience. Energy that is available for other encounters, like taking in the wonder of the view beyond the door. So when we understand the mechanics of consciousness, the makeup of consciousness, the makeup of our manifesting experience, we relax into a space of appropriate context. We begin to understand the context of the mind, and we don't assign it greater power or greater authority than what it deserves. We're free to use the tool of our mind effectively and efficiently. In fact, it operates by itself very well. We don't have to do anything more. It already is an intelligent tool. And if we free ourselves up from actually taking on the identity of that construct, we are then free to be the experience of ourselves as an instrument of life, that which is forever open, forever flowing. That's where the dance comes from. Because then, yes, the mind is there when we need it, we don't need to worry about that because it's part of our makeup. We can't divorce ourselves from it. It's like trying to say, you want to stop living, so hold your breath. Can you stop your breath? No. Can you stop the function of the mind? No. But we certainly can make choices to live from a different dimension of our being, let the mind do its work, and be present. Simply be present. Be aware. Be centered in our heart. Be centered in consciousness. Be connected at the innermost essence of our being. Recognize that spark. This spark is the center of all things. Everything is the center. So when we encounter that, there's the paradox. We have this reference point. We are always the center. Yet if we are connected, utterly connected with our own innermost center, simultaneously we realize that everything is center. There is no outside, inside, left, right, up, down, here, there. There is only center.
So when you say there's only center, or every place is the center, well, then maybe there's really no space, or there's somehow such a close identification with all things seen and perceived. And this is what we talk about. We call it love, or we call it compassion, or we still in the construct part of the formula, actions appear, and those actions also evoke compassion. And if we're in some way not identified with the construct, we still feel that compassion. And
absolutely.
And actually, I kind of want to say that in the realm of the construct, action is made up of omission and commission. Mostly we think of commission when we commit something. But actually action is made up of omission also, because if we, for instance, delegate somebody to do a service, and we omit to watch them or watch over what they're doing, then if it gets out of hand, what did we do?
We abdicated conscious presence. We abdicated our power. We abdicated our communion. That's what we did. And this is a very interesting point, because I see this is what is happening with this dysfunctional element of society now. That if we look at the way our world is, what we've given our power to, what we're chasing in general terms, okay, the larger populace on the planet. It is quite dysfunctional. And how and why have we come to that? Well, this is an interesting point that you just made. The difference here between action and, how did you put it?
Well, I just said that action is made up of, commission. We usually think of commission, yes, as an action, but actually omission is an action too, especially if you've
exactly
delegated. If you've delegated certain powers to your government, or I'm thinking mostly of the banking systems right now, and then you just turn away and say it's all too complicated, but you have a real strong belief that the whole society is bulletproof. And whatever they do is not going to, they can't crush this society and they can't crush this world. And so
absolutely,
then you just toss it and say, well, it's a resignment, isn't it?
A resignation, absolutely. And, people are either in resignation or wanting to bail out altogether, which is another aspect of omission. And this is a very important point for a shift of consciousness on the planet now. Our capacity to recognize this, that our dysfunction is based on the omission, is vital. And I put it in terms of the abdication of conscious presence, the abdication of self-presence and self-power. Why? If every single one of us can remember that we are the center of existence, from this center, we are creation. From this center, which is self, we are cause and effect. If every one of us can remember this, we can live in each moment with conscious response. That means we are the aware response of every action, commission or omission. In fact, there is no omission when we are conscious response. That conscious response means we're present to our true nature, each one of us unique and authentic, fulfilling a role and a purpose within the whole. As we each fulfill our role, we encounter each other as center. When we encounter each other as center, there is true communion. And what is happening on the planet? We have broken down true communion. This is the thing that actually people are looking for. Do you know, in surveys, when it's asked, what is it that makes you happiest? Do you know what the highest response is? Acts of kindness. That's the highest response. What is the thing that makes you happy as a person? Acts of kindness, either being the recipient of an act of kindness or being the doer and the giver of an act of kindness. And what is that about? That's about a communion. That's about an engagement with each other, with life. It's about a recognition of the value of life within ourselves and with each other. And when we lose communion with each other, we lose our sense of meaning, our sense of purpose. We're miserable. And that miserable state produces this incredibly deep feeling of a hole, the point you made right at the beginning, that something is missing. It creates this feeling of enormous lack in one's being. There's a rift in one's being, not just in oneself, but with society, with life, with one's mother, father, husband, partner, community, whatever it is. There's a rift. There's a disconnection from this alive connection that is actually here in and with everything. And when we have that disconnection and that gap grows and we are misidentified with the construct, we develop deeper and deeper attachments to the physical realm because we misperceive it to be our place of security. We misunderstand where security abides, and we project all of our needs for security into the material realm. We try to make things bigger, last longer, be louder, give more impact, be more powerful, whatever it is. And we all know the more you project into the material realm, the further away you get from being in touch with the essence of life, the further away you get from true joy, the further away we get from true communion with each other. We become isolated, lonely, miserable creatures of existence. We're not flowering human beings. That's what we're seeing on the planet now. We are withering, wilting, miserable creatures. Wow. And that's pretty sad, isn't it?
It's shocking, all right. It's shocking, and the more we seek our safety, the worse it gets, for sure. And the more we seek our safety by that method, mm-hmm. by believing in that security is all something I have to do by myself. Security mm-hmm. is something I have to invent, and I have to hold it up and support it all. And this is a huge job, and I can't really do it.
And everyone's chasing the money wheel, you know, to survive. Everyone's running after more money. You know how many times I see and hear people coming up with the reason or the excuse as to why they cannot come and share in, for example, a sacred weekend. You know, oh, but I've got too many responsibilities. I can't afford this. I can't afford that. I've got to work. Work for what? What is everyone working for? What is everyone trying to hold up? Misery. Really? If we're honest about it, if we're blatantly honest about it, everyone is working to hold up an unsustainable lifestyle. And not only is that an unsustainable lifestyle, it's one that is producing greater and greater misery, greater and greater conflict. And of course, that's just leading to a breaking point. Look at our global society now. The upheaval, the breakdown of our economic systems, it's all collapsing. And in the midst of it all collapsing is still the unconscious response that's trying to grasp for more of the same thing to prop itself up. And there is a perfect living example of the definition of insanity. Doing the same thing over and over and over and expecting different results.
Well, we're just kind of like little mice that are trained to do a certain trick. We're a one-trick pony, and then that's kind of like it'll last way beyond its usefulness, right? But in some ways, you know, we're separated also by a lot of beliefs, and those beliefs come to fruition as institutions. And the institutions I'm talking about are the banking institutions, the ownership institutions. The regeneration of capital. I mean, I don't want to sound like the Karl Marx's manifesto, but in a way, I mean, there's a huge imbalance, and the economy really depends on people interacting, and people. That's what the market means, that we can trade our energies, but some of that energy is drained off. You know, this is the kind of like an economic theory, I guess. And it's out of balance. Too much is drained off. Drained off where? Drained off in interest and in dividends and in ownerships and rents and the way things are divided up. Those are institutions. So some people play that game really good. Now to call them greedy, I think the rules should be changed. And it takes an engagement to look at the rules and see that the rules just mean the laws of how these institutions work. And how markets work and so on.
To me, the rules are what we as individuals choose to engage with. And you talk about the...
Well, I'm talking about the construct. It's a construct. The rules in the construct.
Yeah, absolutely. And it still comes down to what each of us as an individual choose to engage with. Do we choose to engage with that construct, or do we come back to conscious presence and respond with conscious awareness? Is it really the rules that are to be shifted, or is it our state of awareness that is to be shifted? If our state of awareness is shifted, we will produce a very different construct. For example, you talked about the economy and trade and what it is. It's an interaction between people. And what is that based on? What was the point I was making earlier? It's actually based on, first and foremost, communion. How we are present in ourself and how we meet each other. So if our consciousness shifts in a way that we reconnect with our own center, we will reconnect with each other's center, and we will regain true communion instead of the system as it is, this construct as it is, like you say, which is profoundly out of balance. And the siphoning off, is it simply a matter of mismanagement? Well, no, it's about coveting. And where does that coveting come from? It comes from those individuals who are so disconnected from their center. They are so profoundly in fear that they have to accumulate greater and greater material mass to believe they exist, to believe they are powerful enough to exist, for example. That's based on a profound depth of fear.
I totally understand you, that it takes a new consciousness to create new rules and new new institutions, let's say. And but if it just takes a non-greediness or to abide by the same rules in a different way that's not too grasping, I'm not so sure that that can really work, because there's no reason for people that are working within the rules, but to the maximum, to the maximum self-benefit, there's no reason that that would that would really soften in any way. I think those rules need to be retouched, and I don't see why they shouldn't be. And if we have to wait till everyone is kind of awakened in order to see some mutual caring and see our structures cherished instead of battered, you know, our mm-hmm. structures are being battered, and they need to be cherished and really preserved as a steward with stewardship.
And absolutely.
And not and so then I think that takes definitely a different consciousness to be able to build a structure that would be better suited for that. But I guess I will go one step farther to say that somehow I think in acts of omission, the spiritual community might be the most guilty of ignoring and extracting themselves from the world of constructs, and maybe a good part of the reason why it's in the state that it is.
I agree with that, and I guess I see what we're talking about here, that there are different points of distinction in that process. So, for example, when we talk about the shift of consciousness that's required and the release of fear, you know, the release of individual consciousness from fear, which, of course, releases one from greed. And anything which creates an imbalance between the whole comes from greed, essentially, self-interest. So,
well, from fear, let's just keep saying from fear.
Sure. When I make reference to that, there's two points in that. One is that that is the ultimate outcome, and it is the central cause shift. Okay, it's coming back to where is the root cause of the issue in us as individuals and a society. And in between that root cause and the ultimate outcome, of course, there's an incredible process. And it's not going to be ultimate. Like you say, there's no way we're going to sit around and wait for all people to awaken for a more workable construct for our society. Of course we can't. In the meantime, however, each one of us recognizing it is about a shift in ourself really is the first key. If we take responsibility for that, we ourselves take different actions. We ourselves become engaged, like you say, instead of using the spiritual identity as some reason to opt out of society. It's a reason to engage consciously with society. It's only when we do recognize that that we will have sustainable spirituality. And this is a key topic that I'm very passionate about. In fact, it probably sums up what I like to share with people, what I want to inspire in people and bring awareness to, is that what we're really looking for is spiritual life that is sustainable. And that means sustainable human relations and sustainable environmental responsibilities. And of course, from that shift in ourself, when we do take responsibility, we're going to have very naturally a shifting, very gradually, yes. Nothing's going to happen rapidly overnight, is it? No, it took a long time to build up the construct we're living with. And there's an enormous amount of resistance to its collapse.
Right, right. You know, but I mean, We could say it took a long time to build it, but it won't take very long for it to crash, because when something collapses, that's a collapse, you know. It could happen in
Sure.
weeks. It could happen in weeks, honestly. And
Sure.
when you start to realize that, and then you realize when you we were saying before that people are working and never can get enough, you know, and they're going to be so surprised when they realize that all those dollars they put aside are really just tissue paper, and they can't buy anything, and their nice little pension is just fried, and it's happening to many people. And so finally we're starting to admit it, because some of those people are our friends. But before, when they were just one class of people, like the poor or something like that, we were just saying, well, they were unworthy. In some way, they didn't get behind the system. In some way, they didn't work hard enough. In some way, it was their fault. But now we can see even
That
our
was
son.
their karma.
Yeah, it was their karma. Now, somehow, now we're seeing even our sons and daughters are, or, you know, our grandkids or whatever are getting out of college and there's no jobs for them. Hey, big deal. How about that? And then actually, I was actually. I guess I'll share. I was at a town meeting this morning with a congressman here. And it's amazing where people's attention get twisted to, because there was a lot of people complaining about the borders are open, and that immigrant workers without a without documents come in here and they're snatching our jobs. And it's, you know, it's what can a Spanish American taking a menial job mean for me? But a corporate giant can close 10 factories and shift 10,000 jobs out of the country. I mean, where are the jobs really going? And so then we're, in a way, we're like twisting our attention to something that really is not at all important, or not a cause, you know. And we're just becoming divisive as a last resort. Scream, I guess.
Territorial.
Territorial.
It's yeah, territorial mentality. Again, it's coming back to fear and attachment at the material level. Because everyone's seeing that we are living unsustainably at the material level, which means the mind recognizes, okay, there's getting less, and my own material world is at risk, so I better protect my little plot. I better push away anyone else. That's the territorial mentality, and we're going to see a lot of that. That's going to increase enormously on this planet over the next decade. We're going to see a great amount of upheaval based just on that one point.
No, I heard that this morning too, because I got there an hour early, started talking to a lot of people, and some of them said, "Oh, the government's a total failure, and there's something in the Constitution that allows for private militias." This is too much, you know. Not only do they want guns, now they're going to have private armies. And I ask them, like, "Well, okay, like, are you the general, or can I be in the army too, or what?" You know. And I said, "I want to be the general, and what'll happen? I'm going to go to your office. You'll be there. And I'm going to say, hey, would you fix my streets, and besides my sewers, flood my basement every, are you going to do it any better than the guys that are in there now, or how's it going to change, really? And are you going to have less taxes and more services, or how?" And I don't know. It's an amazing thing that mind grasps at anything. You're so right that there's going to be a lot of territorial squabbling.
And the irony of all of that is that here we are, this human life, that at the end of the journey, we realize that that all crumbles into dust again anyway. The only thing that carries on is the love, the inspiration that we've given to another, the gift we've given to life, how we've taken care of life, how we've taken care of the natural world. That is the only thing that continues.
I love what you said, because I was studying sustainability last year. And mostly we think about it with regards to energy and resources. And then we can talk about it with regards to human relationships and workers and employee-employer relationships and services for the community. But I've never heard of, or never thought of spiritual sustainability. And that's it's a very exciting to put those two words together and just see, like, what could be fundamental to all the other sustainabilities.
Well, Like I say, that's my passion. That's what I'm here to deliver, is the exploration and this whole topic, as I term it, sustainable spirituality. So I feel there's a shift. There's a required shift, actually, in regards to our spiritual, I don't know, spiritual explorations, concepts, references, the way we approach spirituality. I really feel there's a required shift, and that shift is coming. We're on the verge of that shift. You know, as much as we have wonderful historical spiritual knowledge we can draw on, it's got to be reoriented to apply to where we are at as an experience here now in this 21st century. And what is that about? This is about our experience as a human being, and how do we address a sense of conflict about being human and being part of the society and being part of this life on this planet that is now threatened? Really, that's what it's about. It's about coming back to a realization of our connectivity and putting that in practical measures, not philosophical measures. Yes, let's certainly recognizing something more deeply, its essence, be able to consider that and contemplate that. But if that's not going to translate into something practical, of what point is it now with what's happening in our life, in our world?
How could it, you know, when you think about it, how could it be practical? How could it translate into something practical? Because you're taking your attention and you're putting it on what someone told you, right? And then you're also saying, okay, well, that's my experience too. But somehow that experience is filtered or focused or somehow drawn through that spirituality and share, you know, that tradition, let's say.
Mm-hmm.
And somehow what you're saying is when we're totally connected, when we are here now, every moment, spirituality remanufactures itself in every moment. It's always fresh. And
absolutely.
And nothing is needed to be known. No knowledge need to be brought into the mix.
No, because there's just conscious response, and that is where practicality comes in. When we have conscious response, we are engaging with life. We are participating with life consciously. That's when we do know with awareness what to do practically. We don't just sit ourselves in some room and close our eyes and meditate forever. We get involved with the world, with love, with awareness, with each other.
I do want to put a couple of words in to honor spiritual traditions, in other words. And so then I want to ask you, like, I mean, let's say we do go on our meditation cushion, and let's say we do seclude ourselves for even decades, right? And mm-hmm. somehow, let's see, we say we do believe in this, that first we must see some form of truth before we can really be useful at all in restructuring society or anything like that. And so then many times, is that what it takes, that you have to kind of closet yourself and somehow seclude yourself and hold out the other just to get that exaggeration of, I mean, I don't want to trash at all and say that we're all totally remiss.
No.
We're totally remiss,
no.
But I want to also see how much it takes. What does it really take? How much do we have to step aside for how long?
Well, that can only be determined by each individual. But certainly I agree with what you're saying, and I wasn't at all suggesting we throw away that passage of seclusion, that rite of passage into a deeper awareness in ourselves.
I probably was.
Yes.
I probably was suggesting we throw it away, so I wanted to come back a little bit.
Well, I mean, this is the interesting thing. It's about the shifting from left bank to right bank to left bank to right bank. We go from extreme materialism into extreme seclusion, you know, and then gradually that shift between our attachment to the construct and our removal from it, it gradually moves into a centering point where we realize the oneness of, you know, the construct or the world of form and our interaction with it and our inner consciousness. We come to a middle point with that. In the meantime, yes, for some, it is going to require a passage of complete seclusion in order to disengage from that so-called known construct and from all the distractions and from the things that pull us out of our center and pull us into that externalized projection. Yes, it is necessary. For some, that may be for a lifetime. For some, that may be just half an hour in the morning daily, you know. And I think in general, if we're talking about most people, the way they're living their life now, as it is right now, most people can't just opt out anyway and take a year out or a lifetime out and just sit in you know, a cave and have everything they need at the same time. Most people can't do that. So in general, what I like to remind people is that within your life as it is, within your busyness as it is, you can create a space of stillness that will give you something deep and rich. It will provide you with a different connection in your being. It will provide you with the space you need to refresh your awareness, to wipe your mind clean for a few moments from all of that noise, all of those distractions, give you the way to disengage from those fears and engage with your essential self. And that is so valuable now in our society, that capacity for us to create just those little moments of stillness and silence, the quietness of going into the room of our own heart, our own inner being. That's what's most valuable now.
Say a little bit more about, like, I think you said the middle way, or you know, I mean, because that's not really well understood. I mean, okay, you know the vastness, and you know the obligations of your agreements, which is the construct. And a middle way is not really an average of those two, but is it like being able to? Is it a bifurcation? Like your attention can go on both at once, or exactly how does that work? You know, there's somehow you never forget, right? That you are have many capabilities.
Speaking from this experience, I certainly have that synergy. It's an ever-present synergy. So I don't even try and think, oh, in this moment, should I sit with a still body and meditate, or should I in this moment be in a meeting or sitting and writing? You know, I don't even think. I'm just living in that synergy of connectedness moment to moment. Most people haven't attained that synergy yet. And that's where I'm saying that if we recognize a balancing and a middle way, that it's important that we can reconnect with that inner presence in ourself, create the stillness and the silence, and from that we bring a different quality into our life. We can continue with our responsibilities, our obligations, and we're going to be able to continue with that in a very different way. It doesn't have to be extreme. We don't have to get lost in that and feel like we're just so obliged to that that we can't have time out for ourselves. And likewise, we don't have to be so afraid of that snowball that we think, well, I've just got to bail out altogether and throw that away, and I'm going to cut myself off from society. I'm going to go into the cave. You know, that's not necessary. And unfortunately, a lot of people think it's one or the other. It's either this or that. It's not. Our essence is always here. Life is going on always. Our actions are unfolding always. We can't stop that. We're a living process of creation. There's constant action, so we can't stop that. We can find the balance. We can honor and recognize the value in the stillness and have that periodically through our day or throughout our week, and continue with our family, with our loved ones, with our skills, with our gift that we can give to society, we can continue with that.
At first, when we're finding out about spirituality, we think that we, you know, we're still believing that we direct our life and that we can direct it, and we can make some rules and follow them because we have a discipline, and we can say how long to meditate or how long, how many practices or how many retreats to go to or how many times to say an affirmation or how many times to try to remember something, and we're kind of directing our life, and in a way that direction is always the same. I mean, however we direct our life, it's because we have an interest, and that interest is, I don't know exactly where that interest comes from, but it comes from somehow a belief that that the end of that road is going to have a light at the end of the tunnel, in some sense. It's a belief that somehow that's going to be productive and really give us what we're looking for. And then at another time, it gets more like automatic, like we don't really have to work through that discipline, but the interest is so strong, and we could call that a love of truth, that we just love to see how it's really working and love to see how our mind comes up, and you know, we're witnessing just because we just love that mechanism and love to watch that, you know. And that's the most interesting because that's just so curious, like how's that doing that thing, and how are those repetitions happening, and how I, you know. And then I would call that like the love of truth that really takes you home, whereas the other one, the discipline, the forcing and trying to really make yourself into a spiritual seeker, that can only take you so far. And really that might be all the excuses and the reasons that, you know, life is no good or I'm suffering or, you know, I've always had this bad feeling about myself. And just call it suffering. Suffering brings so many people to search and to look. And then I'm just wondering, what is that point where suffering turns into the love of what I'm finding? And then that love is just a natural interest that, I mean, you couldn't even keep me away from. I mean, I don't even meditate, you know, like it just silence happens, you know. I don't count my breath or watch it, but I'm always feeling it or seeing it, you know, because somehow it's just such a curiosity. And I guess we're all trying to ignite that, you know, that love of truth. But I mean, what can you comment on that a little?
Actually, I love your comment about curiosity. And I feel this is quite a vital ingredient in reference to this contemplation. And that is that really the coming back to awareness, to witnessing, to this more connected sense is about us becoming curious again. It's about us rediscovering the wonder of ourself and of existence. And it's when we lose that that we begin to suffer. It's when we begin to take on the opinions of society that we lose that childlike nature and wonder and innocence and awe. Witnessing, you know, a child. When does a child stop witnessing? And just engaging from that witnessing space when the child takes on the opinions of the parents, of society. And the more those opinions are taken on, the thicker and stronger and bigger the construct is. So when does a person come back to, you know, just being spontaneously, even that witnessing, because like you say, there is that love of truth, of existence. Well, I guess that's when enough of that big, heavy construct falls apart. And when does that happen? When the person has had enough suffering. Essentially, when the person says, you know what, enough of this suffering, that's when the dismantling begins. And can we measure that? No, again, that's all in the individual experience, isn't it? But certainly
yeah, but it's kind of like when we say there's enough suffering, we're still suffering, right? And the momentum of it is still going. It gets deeper and deeper into suffering, and we're saying enough, enough, scream, 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 but it's still there, right? It hasn't just shifted.
Well, it shifts once we occupy the witnessing state more and more readily. Pain continues, and this is actually an important distinction. You know, I've I've seen how virtually every person who comes and sits in the space when I'm sharing is looking for this escape from suffering and from pain. And as I've pointed out to people again and again and again, if that's what you're actually coming for, you're going to fail. You're going to be disappointed. Because, fair enough, you want to overcome your suffering. That's a human desire because we all seek happiness. But if you're trying to do that based on getting away from pain, you are deluded. Because pain is an integral element of creation, our life, our existence. It's synonymous with growth. Pain corresponds with a process of growth, transformation, transition, whether that's mental, physical, emotional, or spiritual. You cannot erase pain from the experience of life. It's always going to revisit us at some point because we're going to continue growing. We're going to continue transforming. It's our resistance to pain. It's our inability to see and understand the true nature of ourself and existence that causes us to suffer. So if we realize the true nature of ourself and existence, we surrender to it, we accept it, we become the witness to it, and we gain that curiosity again. For example, even if the body's in pain, if we become a witness with it, that can become quite an incredible experience. Pain can be a very fascinating thing. You can actually discover excitement, joy, or wonder, or bliss in pain. And with that discovery, suffering falls away. We don't suffer anymore. Why? Because we're no longer resisting simply what is. We're no longer rejecting what is. And if we don't reject what is, we don't have anything we're trying to attach ourselves to either. You actually can't have attachment without rejection, or rejection without attachment. So our attachment to this false idea of this perfect light-filled life free of pain is the delusion. It's a primary delusion in spiritual seeking. And the moment we release ourselves from that, then the suffering drops away.
I'd like to comment that on that in a little slightly different way, because instead of pain, I'll use another word. And first I'll just take us back to in the beginning we were saying that without a reference point, we wouldn't really have a life.
Yeah.
And I just ask you, I'll ask everyone just to imagine a life where all you ever ran into was yes, there was no no's. And I would suggest that perhaps, the no is the pain or the suffering, right? Mm-hmm. But if there's no no's whatsoever, let's say we had to make up our own life and here we had to write it down, all the things we like, and we just design it so there's all yeses. And we wouldn't really know anything, right? We would never encounter anything, because yes would mean we just go in all directions and there's no obstacles, right? Everybody just bows at our feet and then, we move on, right? It's just total yes. I mean, what would it mean? It would be it would be a nothing life, wouldn't it?
Well, my take on that is that that's a very preferential version of yeses. And when you first started presenting this notion, I felt, oh, yes, wonderful. Because to me, the notion of yes is acceptance rather than, oh, this is my preference. Yes, I want this. No, I don't want that. If we can say yes even to the things we don't necessarily like or want, then we are still encountering life. We're still having the experience, we still have a reference point, and we can be free of conflict. We can actually just say, okay, that's just the nature of existence. There's light, there's dark. There's something coming, there's something going. Yes, ah, yes.
yeah, totally different, because I was trying to lay it out saying everyone's saying yes to us, but we're saying yes to everyone is totally the flip, and that is totally perfect.
way, it's conditional creation, isn't it? It's like, okay, I'll just map out my life so that I can only say yes. And that's why people are suffering. Everyone's actually trying to do that, which is ludicrous. We cannot create a conditional life. That's impossible. And that's, look, that's a very mental projection onto life anyway. The conscious experience and embrace of life sees that there is just the perfection in creation and destruction. We just see that. That's the yes. That's the ultimate yes. You know, the ability to laugh in the face of death, to celebrate it. That's a yes. And what are most people doing? No, no, you can't die. No, it can't be that way. Quick, I better rearrange my life to avoid that thing I don't want there. You know, it's just like shuffling deck chairs around on the Titanic and it's sinking anyway. What's the point? Sit on the deck chair. Take the journey. Oh, this is what it's like to sink on the Titanic. You know, actually, I remember this example, a similar situation. I was on a flight coming from Perth, one side of Australia, back to Sydney, completely opposite sides of Australia. And as we're traveling, we found ourselves in the middle of a violent storm system. And the plane was being thrown about, lightning was striking it, and people were genuinely, utterly terrified, including the air hostesses. And when the air hostesses are terrified, you know something pretty big is going on. Anyway, everyone's terrified, and people are vomiting, and my assistant sitting next to me is equally terrified, and I'm sitting there with this big grin on my face. And she looks at me, "Oh, Syra, how can you be happy and at peace at this moment? We could be about to die." She's freaking out. And well, for me, it wasn't even a choice to be responding in that way. It's just because I am so at one with the existence of self, of life as it is. I just see and experience it consciously that I don't have any prejudice towards any situation. For me, that was, oh, wow, isn't this wonderful? Isn't this exciting? Wow, if we're going down, this is an exciting way to go. That was my experience.
Oh, boy. I think if it ever happens to me, I'll just feel so much love for that pilot.
Yes. Yeah.
I think that's where I would put my energy, like, whoa, I love you so much. And I'm with you all the way, baby.
Yeah. Yeah, and that's what it is. When we're saying yes to everything as it is, we're in love. That's what it is. We are completely and utterly in love with the entire universe, with every movement, every moment, every particle, however it is happening. That is true love. That is unconditional love.
I guess I want to say, I'm not so sure how this will go, but I want to say a few things. Like, I think so many people really want to be a contribution to society and to others. And maybe they're only choosing a few others for now, but, you know, in a way, there's a giant force to want to contribute and want to feel the good of, you know, feel for the good and so add to the good of the planet and leave a legacy, or, you know, not necessarily for fame or for anything like that, but just, I don't know. I can even remember in times in my business life and stuff that, and I wasn't really thinking I was a holy person or anything like that, but somehow I didn't want to engage in vindictiveness, or if someone took my accounts, I didn't want to go back and take theirs. I just didn't want my energy in that, you know. I just knew that that was throwing energy somewhere just down a rat hole, and energy that, you know, I wasn't spiritual either, but, you know, energy that God gave me, I was just somehow. And I never wanted to gamble, really. I never wanted to win. I never wanted to lose. I never wanted to, in other words, gamble means like a zero-sum game where I just get someone else's money. And I only wanted to add value. And you know, for so long, it seemed like it was so, such an old-fashioned way. And I think there's so many people that really, truly, at their heart, maybe it's a karma, you know, it's a good karma or something. They want to be positive, and somehow we don't really know how to do it in this, you know, we're saying everybody's greedy and everybody's self-serving, but I'm not so sure that's really the case. And the institutions are in such a way that it doesn't really leave room for people that have this feeling. I mean, you can volunteer, you can send money to charities and stuff, but somehow, I don't know. I think that's a force to be reckoned with, and it doesn't really have its outlet. It doesn't have a vehicle that can really carry it. It doesn't seem to in this world. I don't know. Am I wrong on that?
Oh, I wouldn't say you're wrong. I just see that it's a reflection in relation to a certain context of society. And I feel what that comes back to is the point I was referring to before about communion. And that, yes, at the heart, in the deepest essence of every human being is kindness, is love, the desire to be loved and to love. And it is when we lose connection with that, however that happens, whether we've been violated or whether we've taken on the big construct of so many false beliefs, whatever it is, if we lose contact with the essence of ourself as love, as that which is lovable and that which is capable of loving, we bury ourselves in deeper and deeper fear and deeper sense of disempowerment and a feeling of being disengaged. And when we reconnect with that love, even if it is just momentarily, if someone does a kind act for us, it gives us faith again in that essence, the love that is within us as a human being. It re-engages us with humanity. It brings us back to communion. And I feel that one of the most powerful things happening in a new way spiritually now are circles and organizations who base themselves on the notion of random acts of kindness. This is an outlet. It's actually an outlet for every single one of us. There is the absolute potential for every single one of us to do an act of kindness every day. And whether that is a big or a small act, it creates something great. It creates that communion. It creates a reconnection and a re-engagement between ourselves and each other. And it's through that that a greater love flows, that a greater presence, a greater spirit flows between us. A greater sense of purpose and meaning is rediscovered in that communion.
That's actually exactly what I wanted to ask, because I was going to say, well, maybe there's not enough context for acts of kindness. And you're saying there is. In this case, this is something, some group or some movement that says, let's go out and make a context. And let's make it not only just as random acts of context, kindness, let's make it as, you know,
organized
and considered, you know, and let's do it in our businesses and in our daily relationships and in, when we're a consumer And the neat part about that is it's a double payback, because we're not only doing some kindness for somebody and making them feel well about their day, but we're also allowing love to flow. And for some reason, we're so screwed up by thinking that if we stop love within ourselves, we're actually punishing someone else. And really, we're just, it's self-flagellation at the worst, you know.
Absolutely. And where that love flows also is back to ourself. And that brings me back to the earlier comment regarding statistics in surveys, that people clearly indicate that what makes them happiest is actually kindness. Doing a kind act. You know, that when we're being kind, we have an energy that emerges from within us. Because, see, this act of kindness, it's not something, or joy, for example, it's not something we take from outside. It's something that emerges from within. It's the love and the light and the joy that's inside of us that finds an avenue to express itself. And the more we can express that, the more it grows, the more it flows. So the more we actually recognize that which was already there, our joy and our love. And it's through that active participation that we discover greater and greater happiness. Kindness and happiness and joy comes from inside to the outside. And what we think is a feeling of happiness actually isn't because we've seen someone else happy and it's coming back to us. It's actually because it's just mirroring that joy, that love that is within our being. And that's why it's proven also that acts of kindness and loving acts improve our health. People who regularly do kind acts have better health, are less stressed, do not suffer from depression, feel a sense of purpose and meaning in their life, etc. That's what makes us alive as a human being. Otherwise, sure, we can breathe, we can walk around, we can work, we can ride in a car, we can collect fancy, pretty objects in our house, but that's just existing. If we're not loving, we're not alive.
I feel we said things that are so practical. And nothing esoteric, or nothing that you have to really study for, or you don't have to go hide or be another person or be another culture. I mean, everything is just so practical and useful in exactly what's happening right now. And even the crisis things that are happening right now, it's even more practical for that. I mean, there's nothing more practical than what we're saying.
Absolutely. And that's what I was saying before. Spirituality really must translate into the practical. If we keep it esoteric, really, it's not serving us at a living level. Okay, it might provide some kind of process for us initially, a passage of contemplation perhaps. Perhaps it leads us to something else. But ultimately, where's it pointing us to? It's actually pointing us right to this. Something very, very simple, very human. Very accessible, very applicable, because that's what we actually are. We're this right now.
Absolutely right. If it's esoteric, it's just another excuse for separation, and separation in a cultish separation, specialness. Yeah. It's actually going exactly in the wrong direction that it claims it's going.
And dare I say it, it's even a form of mental masturbation, really. You know, you're just going over and over and over, indulging this gratification in the mind. You know, just puffing up the idea of another mental concept.
Right. It's just deifying, what did we call it, the contact with others, but never getting to the point of actually doing it, right? Just saying oneness, oneness, but never really, humanity's wonderful, but humans are rotten.
Yeah.
I've totally enjoyed, I mean, I don't know, I think we were just as deeply heartfelt and deeply intellectual as anyone I've ever talked with. It made so much sense, you know, that there's really nobody can be put off by any part of what our conversation contained. And I'm totally thrilled by meeting you and hope to have a relationship that is enduring.
Beautiful. Me too. Absolutely wonderful. And I concur. All your comments, just truly wonderful sharing, and may many people gain something from it. You know, let's hope that it reaches many, many more people and inspires people to recognize this simple, practical truth in their own life, right here, right now.
Thank you so much, Asaira.
Thank you, Richard. Deepest love, gratitude, and honor.
And thanks, everybody. This is just a little taste of all the wonderful things that are in the world. And we just found this one in Australia. So, but, you know, this is a practicality that is worldwide. And I think you're going to notice it faster than you've ever dreamed possible. And that's just my little predilection. So thanks for being involved with us, and I hope that what we bring to the table is valuable and eye-opening and heart-opening and practical in your daily life, in your community, and in our world. So thanks for being a part of what we're doing, and tell us what you like to hear, and tell us what you like about what you do here. So thank you, thank you. Wonderful.
Great. Yeah. Thank you, Richard.